Brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, praise the Lord, alleluia. Let us study another parable today. It is a parable of the prodigal son. Preachers say a prodigal son is saved and the elder son is lost. Is it true? Let us study this. Parables have mysteries. Disciples must know them, but not others. Jesus often speaks to people in parables. Matthew chapter 13, verses 10 and 11 says, "And the disciples came and said unto him, Why speakest thou unto them in parables? Verse 11 says, He answered and said unto them, Because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given." We think that Jesus uses parables to help people to understand them. But it is just the opposite. He uses parables as riddles so that common people may not understand the mysteries, but he only wants his disciples to understand them. Parables are like secret code language. Verse 12 says, "For whoever hath to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance, but whosoever hath not, from him shall he taken away even that he hath." It will make his disciples to know better, but it will make others not to know, or they will be confused. Verse 13, "Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seeing see not, and hearing they hear not, neither do they understand it." Jesus says that it is designed that way, since most Christians are not sincere and they do not want to know the truth. In the parable of the prodigal son, the father is symbolic of God, and the two sons are two kinds of believers. In Luke chapter 15, verses 11 and 32, Jesus tells the story of a rich father and his two sons. This is known as the parable of the prodigal son. A parable is a story on the outside, but inside it is a mystery. Common people study this as a story with interpretations, but the followers of Jesus Christ will learn the mystery which is inside the story. Here, the father is symbolic of God and the two sons are symbolic for two kinds of high-level believers who are in the status of the sons of God. But they do not represent the common Christians. Jesus talked about common Christians, but not in this parable. So it is not about us. However, let us study this parable with an open heart. Luke chapter 15, verses 11 and 12. Luke chapter 15, verse 11. "And he said," that Jesus said, "a certain man had two sons." Verse 12. "And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living." Here, the father is symbolic of God, and the younger son asked the father to give him his share. Please listen carefully. God has kingdom in heaven as well as he has the kingdom on earth. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 28, Jesus says, "If I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then kingdom of God is come unto you." That means the kingdom of God is in this world. That is an example of the kingdom of God in this world. So the kingdom of God on earth is one that manifested, that's manifested with power through the gifts of the Holy Ghost. In this case, Jesus Christ himself had the power from God the Father. This younger son asks the father and receives his share while he is on earth. He shares his share was given to him. He asked God the Father and the share, which in the form of the manifestation, the power, the gifts of the Holy Ghost, and it was given to him, and it is from the kingdom of God on earth. It's not from heaven. It is heavenly gifts, but the thing is, it is to manifest in this world. It is given from the kingdom of this world. And so, he foregoes his inheritance in heaven. There is a danger part of it. Maybe he realized it or not. I don't know. The Bible does not say that. The younger son began his ministry by the gifts of God with manifestations. Verse 13, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together with all the gifts and with the power to manifest and those kind of things, and took his journey into a far country. Why is a far country? Because he moved away from the reality of God. Because he's not connected with God, he went away from him. That was a far country. And there we wasted his substance with riotous living. Please do not look at it as a story. If you look at it as a story, then we will miss it. But look at it as a parable. The younger son detached himself from God, but he has the gifts and power of God and began his own ministry in his own way, but not under God. It is a ministry of God as a preach the gospel and show the manifestations, but it's not under the direction of God the Father. He took it upon himself. He detached from him. He went away to a foreign country, and he was doing that over there. He became famous. Eventually, everybody who show this kind of miracles and manifestations, they became famous. And big crowds follow him, naturally, because of the manifestations. He followed the crowd, lived a luxurious, famous, worldly life, and gradually the power of God began to fade. He became like our celebrity preachers, who has 90% of the prophecy wrong, 90% of the healings are fake, and so on. So that's the way the our celebrity preachers, and so also he became one of them. And as the power of God completely faded and wasted away, the ministry study declined and became fake. Verse 14. And when he had spent all, that was completely all gone, he said, now it's all man-made, and his fake ministry, arose he a mighty famine. There arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want, because completely God's presence and anything completely is out, so it's a famine. And he went to join then that means when he realized that he's lost all the gifts, he tried to depend on other fake ministers of the world. In verse 15, and he went to join himself to a citizen of that country. That means he's completely of the world now. And he sent him into his field to feed swine. Verse 16, and he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave it to him. He wanted to mix in with the world, with participating everything to him. People did not accept him. He's like a salt who lost his favor. So nobody wanted him. Now even they don't want him. They kick him out. So he's away from the God's people. Now even the worldly people don't want him. They kick him out because he lost his favor. Swine are pigs, and it is speaking of figurative of ungodly, worldly, filthy people. He served them, ate their food, and lived in it. Even they were rejecting him. Verse 17, and when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my fathers have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? It is a spiritual things given in the worldly language, so we have to understand that. When he came to himself, he he realized his pathetic condition, remembered how well the conditions of the servants in the house of his father, but our celebratory preachers, and he at least realized at this point, but our celebratory preachers, and they show fake miracles and fake healings and all those kind of things, and but they never realized, like the younger son realized that he is in nothing, zero. And they don't realize, the fake celebrity preachers will never come to their senses. So they will end up in hell. The prodigal son repented, returned to his father. Father received him, celebrated his return, and restored him. He decided to ask the father to accept him as a servant. He came back to his father, verse 18 to 24, it's a little longer passage, verse 18. I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Verse 20. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Verse 21. And the son said unto the father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. So he recognized that he is no more worthy to be called as a son. The sons of God is not born to father like human beings born to their father, but it is adopted because it is grown into the status of the sons of father. So it need worthy, but people sometimes say, I am not worthy, those kind of things. That's a kind of cliche, meaningless statement. When you come to God, you have to have godliness, you have to have holiness, you have to grow in righteousness, those kind of things. We have to grow into that. And the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. Verse 23. And bring hither the fatted calf and kill it and let us eat and be merry. Verse 24. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. The Father God is most righteous, because this father is a kind of picture for Heavenly Father, God the Father. So he is a very righteous person. He is a very holy person. He always will do the things within his principle of truth. He always do the right thing. Verse 10, the same chapter, the beginning of the parable. Verse 10, likewise I said unto you, there is joy. There is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. So the father celebrated the conversion of a sinner. It is no favoritism because he's a son of those kind of things. You know, only as a story, if we study that way, we may not get this. Now, he was a sinner, now there is a conversion of a sinner, heaven rejoice. Verse 22 says that the father put on his son the best robe, a ring, shoes. So it was a great celebration since his sinner has repented. But the ignorant smart aleck preachers pick up the robe, ring and shoes and preach a lot of nonsense. They bring him up to the father or even above the father. So many things. They elevated the converted sinner, the younger son, way above, out of bound. They exaggerated him, preach a lot of nonsense. Further, preachers compared the prodigal son to the sinners, common sinners. This parable has nothing to do with common sinners. This is a high level who were in the son's level. That's the comparison here in this parable. And this they preach connecting these two sinners who love to sin and like to remain in sin. they are sinners, they will not be converted, but they compare them to the prodigal son, and they say they come to Jesus, he will accept you, the Father is open, lot of, okay, I did not go to the details, I don't want to go to the details. So, they tell them that God will receive every sinner, that's a lie. No, the prodigal son has repented. That's what the preachers preach, they don't preach this. Prodigal son has repented of his sins. He came back to be a sincere servant and not to sin anymore. He's completely fall to the, he was submitted to the Father. He was converted from sinning, he will not sin anymore. And the elder son never transgressed, that's what the scripture says, never transgressed God's commandments. And he inherits all from his father. Verse 25. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. The elder son was in the field of the father. Field is a place of work. In this case, it's a mission work or gospel work or the work of God. He was doing the will of the Father, as the man Jesus was doing the will of God the Father when he was in this world as a man. It is the true ministry of God. It is under God. It is the power of, with the power of his manifestations. And this is genuine ministry. But the younger son wants to run it in his own, this is his own show. He wanted to become famous for his fame and his profit with no care for the salvation of souls, and he ran it as he pleased, for riotous living. So he wasted it and lost his share. The elder brother did it all according to the commandments of his father, which was a picture of God the Father. One day he came home from the war, and he found that there was a festival, celebration. Verse 26. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. Verse 27. And the servant said, and he said to him, thy brother has come. Thy father has killed a fatted calf because he hath received him safe and sound. It is a parable, and so it is a picture of a celebration in heaven. So the celebration is here, the Father is doing it, but the meaning is, it is heaven celebrates the conversion of a sinner. The elder brother was informed about his younger brother's return. Verse 28. And he was angry and would not go in, therefore came his father out and entreated him. He was angry. He had no problem to receive his brother back. But why was the party? Why was the big celebration? The father came and explained to him why was the need for a celebration. It is for us to know. For us, we are studying the scripture, but we have to know. For us to know that it is proper to celebrate the conversion of a sinner. Even heaven celebrates it, even the angels celebrate it. So it is proper that we celebrate that. The prodigal son has repented, humbled, came back to the father, not to sin anymore, and to be a servant of God, a humble servant of God. And he was in the ministry as the son before, but he wants his personal ministry. That's why he asked for it, and he got it, and he backslid, became a sinner, and so he lost it all. But he has repented, came back to his father to sin no more, to be a good servant of God. Verse 30. But as soon as this thy son was come, which had devoured thy living with harlots, and because he has immortal life also. See, when guy backslid from God and go away, start his own ministry, those kind of things, they end up with adultery. And thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. Please skip verse 31 and read 32. It was meet for we should make merry, be glad, for this brother was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. Heaven rejoiced for the repentance of a sinner. Backsliding is death in the spirit. Conversion, not to sin anymore, is back to life. He came back to life like a dead man raised from his death. And his status as a son is restored and his past sins are forgiven. However, since he wasted his share, he lost his inheritance in heaven. However, he was called a son. The son was son. He's a son in heaven with no inheritance, and he may serve God as he's a loyal priest in heaven. Son without inheritance is a high next level, who's a royal priest who serves in heaven. In this parable, there are two sons. If there is a third son, there are three sons. If there are, the parable is not there. I'm thinking aloud. If there's one more, one son will never return, because so many people backslided, went back to the world to be just totally lost and go to hell. There is one scenario there that way, because a lot of people will never return. 90% of the people will never return. Maybe just a minority, but a few people may return back to God and come back to reconcile and to become a servant. A lot of people will be gone. They'll be gone for eternity. And there could be one son like that. But this son came back, returned it, and restored as a son. Another one son remained without backsliding at all. He became the bride. He is the bride. Verse 29. And he answering, his father answering his son, said unto his father, the elder son, telling his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgress. See, what's the sentence? He never backslid. He always obeys commandments. And I never transgressed I at any time thy commandments, and yet thou never gavest me a kid that I must make merry, I may make merry with my friends. See, this elder son, God has given him nothing in this world to enjoy. No celebration, no party, nothing. He lived a poverty kind of life, in spite of the fact that he was the best beloved son. A lot of times, oh, God gave me this, God gave me this, and a lot of people boast about it. No, if you are his beloved, true, sincere son, God will not give you anything here, but he reserves everything over there up in heaven. Remember that. Yet, he was obeying all the commandments of God all the time. The elder son represents a group of people, even this world, even living even now, who are particular in doing the complete will of God the Father, even though they do not receive any benefit in this world. They have a hard life with no fun in this world. They are the beloved of God. Verse 31. And he said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, with God, the abiding, the presence of God is with him, with me. All that I have is thine. The elder son are this group of people always has the presence of God with them. God abides with them and in them. Now we come to the highlight of the parable. This is the highlight. People miss it usually. If you study this as a story, you'll surely miss it. Pay attention to this very carefully. This is the conversation of the father to the elder son. Verse 31, and he said unto him, Son, that whatever with me, all I have is thine. See that? Everything which God the Father has, the elder son have with him. Everything is the belongs to the elder son. See the beauty of it? This in the eternity. The only one group who will have all that God has is the bride of Christ. Jesus Christ receives his bride unto himself. We have studied two sons of God, are two groups of people. One has backslidden, lost, and dead. However, he repented, humbled, returned to the Father to serve and not to sin anymore. He will have the glory of the Son, but lost the inheritance in heaven. Even though it is not told here, and it's also real that so many were lost and dead without repentance because they love backsliding and they love riotous living. Out of the two sons, one son lost his inheritance, but his glory is spared, and the other became the bride of Christ. The most blessed group is the bride of Christ. Thank you for listening. May God bless you and be with you. Amen.